The magic is to be available but not get in your way. So that's a design principle that we've tried to follow all the way since. We want to present something useful to you, but if it's not what you want, we get out of your way.
Richard Campbell from .NET Rocks and Runez Radio here at One Astera, where we're doing a series of videos on Visual Studio. And I have the good fortune to be sitting here with Mark Wilson Thomas.
That's me.
Yes. You've been working in the studio space for a long time, like really about making people more productive.
Always been my motivation. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I came here with the perhaps somewhat arrogant view in 2006 that I could maybe help build a better tool.
Right.
And that thing has kept me here ever since.
When I think about the productivity tool of Studio, it's IntelliSense.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it even predates Studio.
Like, I think
it's
so.
Been
I think,
around a long
I
time.
I think if memory serves, it was actually in Visual Basic before we had a single IDE before Visual Studio.
Yeah, and then we had that I used the 97 version of Studio, which was actually a bunch of IDEs together. It wasn't until we got to .NET that we got the universal IDE.
Universal IDE, and a big part of that is IntelliSense, right? So
yeah.
the compiler guiding you along the way, if you like, right?
And I think it's one of those things I think we always take for granted. Like, we've always had it, but it's continued to improve, and you've been a part of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's like oxygen, really, isn't it? That you kind of assume it's there, but when it's gone, you feel bad.
Yeah, miss it a lot.
Take it away, and suddenly you're making spelling errors and moving a lot more slowly.
Right.
Than you used to be.
Well, you just expect when I hit a dot, you're going to give me a list of the things I could select.
No dot and list? What's up with that?
You're broken.
I'm not happy, right? We know people have used it along the line for exploring APIs, and we know that people have been using it for rapid typing improvement so that you don't have to type the whole of that thing, or just little touches like, being able to type initial casing. So like I can say, INPC, and you know that's iNotify property changed, right?
And I
get it from my IntelliSense. So it's my guide, it's my speed help. It does a bunch of stuff for me that I really enjoy. That makes it kind of a bit of a holy grail within the tools. It's a bit of a central place that we don't dare mess with it too much, otherwise we get in people's way.
Well, I think that's an interesting challenge. Like, Studio's got a lot of cool stuff in it, but it's always a challenge of how do you show that new feature to someone or show that capability or that suggestion without interrupting them.
Yeah, exactly. And interruption is your worst enemy, right? Mm-hmm. Because you want the information you want, but not the information you don't want.
Right.
So if you're going to get in my way, so we focus a lot on, very, very fine-grained interactions, making sure that we understand where your focus is, literally down to the small block of square on the screen, the sacred square where your carrot is.
Where are you typing?
Where you're typing, and making sure that we get that right, and don't get in your way when you're doing that. So anything we put there, we have to be super careful to make sure that it's right.
Yeah.
Because it's something that people have a lot of muscle memory for.
For sure. How do you take all that feedback? Like, how do you learn how people are using your product?
Well, the only way to learn is to bring people in to your design process, right? So when we're working, we work very heavily with a combination of things like user studies, where we'll bring people in, but we'll also work with diary studies. We'll also work with customers revealing their feedback to us through a reporter problem, So if you've raised a reporter problem, please keep them coming.
Right? Yeah. You read them.
We read every single one.
Yeah.
People think that's a joke. It is not a joke. We read every single one. We look at those and we try to understand what people are driving at. You can't please all the people all the time.
No.
But we
but I also think you've got to look at it from a Gestalt perspective. You're getting feedback from a lot of sources.
Big, broad surface area.
Right. And you're trying to get to, is there a fix that'll work for the majority of people?
Right. Right. And so over time, things accumulate and you've got an enormous range of stuff that's been built over the years, 20 years of building this stuff. It, suddenly you make a change and that breaks a bunch of people over here. So you have to be super careful.
Yeah, sure.
And so that's another thing we do. We do a lot of previewing. Mm-hmm. So thank you everyone who uses previews.
Yeah.
Because that's so vital to us to understand whether, because it's not about us, it's about how it fits
almost
into
every
your
month
workflow.
Now.
Right? Oh, yeah.
So with all that in mind, about not getting people's way, but actually wanted to help them go faster. Like, how do you introduce a new feature into a space like IntelliSense?
Well, I mean, a great example that I can talk to you about is back in 2017-18 when we were getting ready to start introducing AI assistants into the tooling.
In 2017, you used the term AI assistant.
We sure did.
Because it's super cool now, but 2017, that's a while ago.
It was fairly bleeding edge at the time. We might even have used terms like machine learning back then, but you know, it's the same deal, right? What we're talking about is bringing together great volumes of knowledge and presenting them at the point of need.
Machine learning is a more precise term, but I think it sounds correct.
It's a sort of subset. Depends who you... I don't want to get into a...
There are specialists.
A debate about this, that kind of thing.
That's fair.
Because I could easily get a lot of flames from saying the wrong thing here. But we had the capacity at that point to start to do a better job with IntelliSense than we had done before, right? And by a better job, I mean, when I'm typing, wouldn't it be great if...
Right.
Wouldn't it be great if the system was smart enough to understand my context and recommend the right completion?
Finished my line for me.
Finished my line for me, but don't just present an alphabetical list of, I mean, if you're in WPF, dozens of methods and properties, right?
But the one that's most likely.
Or if you're, you know, I mean, but just let's start the one that's most, or the two or the three that are most likely, right? Given my context. We did get there. And I mean, early on, we got there back in 2017, 2018. We had something that could offer that ranking, but how do we do it, right? How do we not get in your way? How do we not scare the horses, for want of a better word, right? How do we make sure that this thing fits into the flow of the normal IntelliSense user? And so what we did there was we did a bunch of experimentation and ended up with an interface that added these extra stars to the ones and moved them to the top of the list. You might remember that when that started happening for C# first, right? And we did that quite early on. And it produced great results because people could still do the things they did before.
Yes. It's not going to stop you from already your existing flow.
No.
But you might save me some time with that start item.
And that's the magic.
Yeah.
Right? The magic is to basically be available but not get in your way.
Right.
Right. So that's a design principle that we've tried to follow all the way since, right? Is we want to present something useful to you, but if it's not what you want, we get out of your way. So you just carry on typing the same way you always did in IntelliSense with stars, you'll get the same results, right? And we were manic about that.
Yeah.
We made sure that worked, and it's been in the product ever since, and people have loved it.
Now, bring me to GitHub Copilot. Just a couple of years later, you, in like 21, from a subsidiary, like, this is a different thing. It's not necessarily Studio, although clearly Studio works with it.
That's right, and actually there's a kind of intermediate step on the way there.
Oh, yeah.
We did our own line completions, which basically only produced a single line. They didn't do the really super clever stuff that Copilot does, which is basically to be able to take natural language or a comment or something like that and turn that into whole blocks of code. But we did these line completions, and actually were a super useful learning experience for us because they allowed us to figure out some stuff about how that interaction would work. People might have seen it. I hope you have.
Yeah.
It's that gray text stuff, right? So you start typing and the gray text starts to appear.
Right.
But we also wanted, once again, to honor the IntelliSense world, right? Because we know people not only use IntelliSense to explore, but they also use it to steer kind of where they're going next, right? And we took that same ethic and did what we kind of call IntelliSense-driven gray text. So when you move around in that IntelliSense list, it'll change the prediction.
Gray text changes,
yeah. So that's we let you steer it, right? So you see what I mean here? We're trying to honor your previous workflow, but we're also
trying to... If you're just head down typing stuff and IntelliSense is putting, you're not going to interrupt me in any way.
Sure.
But if I just take a little bit look back and see the gray text in action... Yeah, I could see a solution quicker.
That's what we hope for.
That's cool.
And we find that, you know, we started with the whole line completions, but now with Copilot, of course, it's come into its own.
Right.
And now we've got that same feature in Visual Studio. Today, you can use the IntelliSense list to steer the gray text. You get these excellent completions if you're going that way. But if you're going down the natural language line, you equally get a great completion. But the nice thing is, when it appears, here's the gray text. Again, I don't want to get in your way.
Right.
If it's not what you want.
Just keep typing.
Just
never
keep
going to stop me from typing.
Yeah. We never want to get in the way of your typing.
Nobody's happy with a modal dialogue.
No.
Not a thing.
No. And I mean, this is even become even more important as we've started to look at the kinds of stuff we can do now with the chat.
Because we're at the early days of this.
Super early days.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we are really just scratching the surface of what's possible with these large models that have become available. So the start of that wave was really Copilot when it shipped, because it had access to these super huge models running on a service that could deliver really incredible insights in terms of blocks of code from natural language or from what you just typed.
Right, I describe a thing I need to do, you present me some code.
I go do it.
Right.
Right, exactly. And so that was a breakthrough moment, but then there's another inflection point that we've hit now where the sort of natural language driven stuff, I mean, unless you've been living under a rock, you've probably noticed ChatGPT.
Well, yep, maybe a little bit.
Well, chat interfaces are de rigueur now, but there's a lot that we can do that's beyond code completion now because of those much larger models. It enables us to address, you know, domains like, well, what if I could help you with exceptions? Right? What if I could help you when your test goes wrong? What if I could help you write that test? Things that were harder to do back in the great, back in the great, how can I say this?
Was that last year?
I think it was last year. I don't know. But
it gets to this idea of now you're in my workflow where I'm trying to figure out how I write the test properly for this.
Yes, yeah.
You could make suggestions that are in context.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, exactly. So now, I mean, gray text is great for a fast suggestion. But if you've got a situation where, I mean, recognizing the real world properties of these large language models, they are like a friendly and trusty colleague, but they're not going to get the answer right all the time.
Right.
I mean, I don't know when the last time a trusted colleague of yours got the answer right every time.
Trusted colleagues are good, but they're awesome. Not that good.
They're awesome, but you know, you still ask questions, you still have brain engaged,
yes.
Right? And that's how you have to interact with these models. And so you need an interface that actually fits that. Right, and that's the critical piece.
So that it's a dialogue. You're kind
so
of
it's a dialogue
and
a refinement dialogue between you and the. And so this is something that we're just on the verge of shipping for the Copilot chat.
That's
preview,
amazing.
Which will allow us, using a standard chat box and a diff view, allow you to refine with the machine what it is you want to do.
This is not that different from refining search results. Like it's along, like we know this pattern.
Right.
But the fact that we could do it with our code, our own code, and have a sense that the system's learning our code and helping us dial into the next thing.
And I want you to be able to refine stuff the way you like to refine too. So like, obviously you know how to use an editor. I would think so by now, right? So I can actually make small changes with an editor if it suggested something I didn't like. Or I can say, actually, I'd really rather you did it this way and say something else in the dialogue, and it will refine based on that. And only when you're ready do you hit apply.
Right.
So it's that process of there's a transient agreement between us that we are refining together.
Sure.
You and me, I'm being Copilot in this world, right? And once we're happy, you're in control, you hit apply when you're ready to go.
Now, next stage of this is dealing with the issues. You mentioned exceptions. So some new exception capabilities.
That's right. Yeah, I'm super excited about this because exceptions are one of those moments where usually they come upon you by surprise.
Yeah, they're exceptions.
They ambush you. They're exceptional and they cause you to scratch your head for a while. Yeah. And here's what's most likely to happen, right? You scratch your head for a while and then you copy and paste everything into a search engine of your choice. And then you go watch cat videos.
Well, once I have a browser open.
Right. You know. Because, you know, it's temptation in your way.
Sure.
So wouldn't it be better if, instead of that, we had a nice little link next to that exception that said, okay, Copilot, go explain that for me.
Right.
Help me understand what's going on. Give me some kind of rubber ducky suggestions, right? You must have come across the rubber duck programming
paradigm. Sure, yeah, but just explain the problem and you get some ideas.
And back come some ideas that will maybe get me out of jail, that will maybe get me inspired so I'm no longer stuck.
Right.
And I mean, that's one of the moments I'm looking for in any tool building exercises. How can I get you unstuck?
I mean, that's exactly, Copilot's great when I get the blank screen and I'm not sure what to do. And so I describe the problem and it spits me back some code and now I'm not in a blank screen anymore. Mm-hmm. But you just give me another one. The exception comes up. I don't know what to do. I'm frozen at that moment.
Right.
So the fact that I have an action I could take that would give me more information about it, sort of get it into context for me so that it's no less of a surprise. Oh, well, that's what that exception about. Maybe I have a beginning.
Right. And talking about getting started, there's another one that's actually a favorite of mine. Mm-hmm. Really, since we've been doing this, we've been learning a lot more about it. And that's, I'm new to a code base.
Right.
And I'm new to this particular block of code because people working big,
other
old,
people working on it.
Lots. They could be. You could be a maintainer maintaining something that's not even yours. You could be hopping into a new code base at work, you know, because there are dozens of them in your company.
Sure.
And you arrive and you're like, I'm kind of disoriented here.
So, what is this?
So what's your typical answer there? Well, it's probably not the internet, because that knowledge doesn't live on the internet.
No.
It's probably waiting to go find a colleague.
Yeah.
And that can be even worse, because especially if you're on a geographically dispersed team, you might not know.
And they may or may not be correct,
too,
right?
They may not be right either. In fact, it's quite possible that the guy who wrote that code is gone.
Yeah, very possible.
The lady who wrote that code is gone,
yeah.
Right? And so now you need someone to help you out there, and Copilot steps into the breach. And what we found is actually our explain capability, which I took as like kind of bread and butter, really.
Sure.
It's like, okay, it's nice.
Yeah.
Like bread and butter, but I want some jam. The reality is it's turned out to be one of our biggest used features.
So your feedback has been?
Our feedback has been people love explain.
Wow.
And I think in part it's because of this ability to break you into a new thing and
right.
give you enough of an explanation to understand what's going on.
I got to think, if you get a few explanations on a few different bits, you start to paint the picture of, oh, I see how this app works and what's going on. And
then you can follow up with other questions, like, you know, for instance, you've been a maintainer. Somebody says to you, this keeps throwing exceptions. Well, what if I could have a conversation with Copilot about that?
Right.
Well, you can. And a lot of times it's going to come up with useful insights and perhaps even fixes to the problems that it's encountering.
I'm just enthralled of this idea of it's reading my code and giving, or somebody else's code, and it giving me a good explanation of it. Like, that opens the door to a lot of possibilities for me.
It really does, yeah. And I mean, it's doing that on the basis of having really understood pretty much all the public code.
Right. That's where it started. But now getting to know your code.
Now it finds context from your code that helps it understand which bit of that universe does it fit into, and now lets me answer questions.
I mean, I don't want you to speculate too much, but all of a sudden I got all these thoughts about all the things we could be doing next.
Like, you bet.
So what do you look towards next?
Gosh, I'm excited about a lot of things. I mean, you probably tell.
Yeah.
but I think some of the things that do excite me is like, what if we can make this much more grounded in your code base's life cycle,
right.
your code base's artifacts? So there's a lot of stuff that comes up when you're writing code. You know, you've got bug reports, you've got change lists, and all kinds of stuff that come together along with the code to provide even more insight into what's going on.
So start to understand my development pipeline and how we document and explain.
You know, let's say I work for Contoso, right? I want to understand the Contoso way of doing something.
Right.
Let's say Contoso does its exception handling a certain way. What if we could be smart enough to ground ourselves in your repos and understand that's the pattern you follow?
Wow.
Right, and then you're going to go the right way by default, rather than discovering that in a code review later.
Absolutely.
Right.
That's
How cool
some
is that?
Really powerful ideas.
Yeah.
I want to give a chance for folks to interact with you. So,
sure.
If they've got questions or they want to do more, like we could give the you could get them to respond here on the show.
Well, I mean, you kind of heard me say something earlier, which is I'm always on the lookout for places where people are stuck.
Right.
I want to hear about your stuck moments.
Okay.
Like, seriously, I do. Because those are food for me
right.
and for the team, so that we can start to look at ways to get you unstuck in those stuck moments. So a classic stuck moment is the one I mentioned earlier, the exception case.
It's a classic.
But like also the one where I'm in a new code base and I have no idea what's going on, or I'm trying to get myself started up to fix a bug in an unfamiliar place,
yeah.
right? I want to get myself booted up and ready to go with all the information to hand that I need. Those are classic stuck moments where I might spend quite a while just to get productive.
Yeah.
I'd like to shortcut that for you.
Sure.
But I need to understand what those moments are. I can speculate. I've been around for long enough to speculate. But you don't want something that's a fix for me. You want something that's good for you.
And especially if they've got a whole other area that they struggle with. That would be really powerful.
Absolutely, yeah.
Let's wrap this up. And I'll put it out to the audience. You've heard the story from Mark and all the cool features that are already there and some neat ones that are coming. Write a comment on this video. Let us know what you're working on. I can guarantee you Mark's going
to read them all. I promise to read them all.
And let's see what we can get for you next. Thanks so much for watching. We'll talk to you in the next video.